Tonight, I'm going to ask this question, why do we have music? And I'll have to elaborate a little bit on the introduction just to tell you where I come from, because it is maybe a little bit of a wrong title, because I'm not an evolutionary psychologist by no means. I'm basically trained in mathematics, French and music, and I have a PhD in neuroscience. I'm also a bassist and composer. I played on 90 records, and my last CD was nominated for Danish Music Award in 2014. I'm also yes. Fine. Whatever. But so just to tell you that I'm the evolutionary psychology is not really my field, but I'm very interested in what happens with the brain when we listen to music and when we become good at playing music. And my center is what it's doing is that we take people into a scanner, and then we play music for people, and then we run them out of the scanner again and see what happens to the brains. That's what I'm going to talk about today, and I'm going to ask this question. I think it's a very interesting question. It's sort of what the whole field of neuroscience in music evolves around. But before we go to that, I'll have to make a little bit of music with you guys. Just a couple of musical examples. I hope you can sing, at least you are enough so that those of you who don't will probably not stand too much out. Anyway, it's easy because it's not a real difficult song that you're going to sing. It's actually, it's also very ugly because you are going to sing all the bad notes on a C major chord. We call them avoid notes, notes to be avoided, and then you have to resolve them half a step up. So, if I play a C major chord here, then you should sing this. And now you. And the next one. A little bit louder, please. And the worst of them all. The women, and then we take the first one and hold it twice as long. One more time, the last thing. See, I don't know whether you can feel this, but when I come from this flat nine and go to the ninth, it's like my body, whole body relaxes. My shoulders go down and I think, oh, it's so nice. He wasn't going to stay on that chord for the whole evening. And the thing is, this is very interesting because we know a little bit about what happens when this happens. Namely, that we get a little shot of dopamine. So when we go there, that's really nice. And this is kind of interesting, because what is dopamine? You all know it. Dope, it's the brain's dope. It what rewards us when we do something that is very good for our survival. See, that's kind of tricky, because the animals, they don't care. I mean, if you do this, they have made these studies where they play some really, really ugly chords in one part of the cage, and in the other part of the cage, they play these very, very nice chords. And if you put monkeys into the cage, They don't care, they just walk around picking up food anywhere. And and you can measure the time they spent. This is a Nature paper, and Josh McDermott, who did this study, he measured the time the monkeys were in different parts of the cage, and there was no difference. If you do the same with you guys, maybe not in here, but in a room where you play nice chords in one part of the room and bad or ugly sounding chords in the other part of the room, and you don't tell anybody what's going on, everybody's going to these nice chords. Imagine that you play these chords in one part of the room, and in the other part of the room. Something like that, and then you'll just move to the some of you at least. Well, I'm a jazz musician, so I would probably go to the other part. But anyway, so this is very strange, because what is dopamine? It's something that rewards us when we do things that are good for our survival. For instance, when we eat good food, that's really good for our survival. When we have sex, for instance, it's good for the survival of the species. And also when we listen to music that makes it shiver down the spine and, you know, we get the chills from music. This is very strange, because why do we have music? Is there an advantage to having music? I mean, it's a big advantage to me, but to the human race per se, is it an evolutionary advantage to have music? It's kind of hard to explain. I'll go about it in just a second. But this is basically what all music theory is about: tension and release. This was, of course, melodic tension, melodic harmonic tension. But just to go to the other spectrum of musical theory, I'll just make a small exercise with you guys, which shows us something about rhythmic tension. So I'll divide you down the middle here, and we have two parts, two teams. The A team. Sorry. Anyway, you guys, it's very easy. It's very easy to write down on a piece of paper. This. You guys are going to clap 4/4, and you guys are going to clap 3/4 meter. A waltz over here, a march over here. So we start with you guys. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2. Relax. You're rushing. Relax. Okay. Oh, my God. Yeah, it's a very nice way of getting applause. Very cheap way, you could say. But anyway, what you were supposed to be doing, you could feel the tension over here when they started, right? So what you were supposed to be doing was this. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. So, the thing here is that what happens in the hands is always the same. But whether we count it off in four, as a march, or as a waltz, we experience something completely different. So what we are experiencing might be completely different if we are two different persons, even though it's the same thing that we are listening to. And this actually tells us something very deep about how the brain functions. Because what the brain is doing is that it has a model, a march, or a waltz, and it tries to fit the incoming input to the model it has. And if it doesn't fit, it might try to change it, but as this has two models, it can be very difficult to fit. And if you're from Denmark, you probably would think of this as a 3-4. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Whereas if you come from Ghana, you would think of it as 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So there's a big difference, but we don't notice it usually when we go around in the world. And here's something that is very important. The model that we have for looking at the world is a predictive model. So what we are talking about now is actually prediction. What the model is doing is it's trying to make it simpler for the brain to understand the world, because the brain is trying to predict it. And this is basically what music is based on. So what music does is that it creates predictions that it can fulfill or do something different. Yeah, that's very nice. That's very nice. That's a clear prediction. And this is actually one of the principles about dopamine, because is prediction, to be able to predict the future, is that good for our survival? That is super good, because we don't get over the street, at least not push a street, without being able to predict where the others are. Might be difficult if you have spent too much time in Pusher Street. But anyway, but the thing is that it's really important for our survival to be able to predict the future. And therefore, when we predict correctly, we get a little bit of dopamine, a small sample of dopamine, a small kick from the dopamine, you can say. So when you predict correctly here, you can feel the dopamine. Nice, isn't it? So, but that has a problem. This has a problem, because if this was the only principle, now dopamine is not as easy or as simple a drug as some people think. So if this was the only principle that you get rewarded when you predict correctly, in order to reinforce your correct predictions, then you'd be listening to music that would go like this. And so forth. That's a little bit boring. and actually, yeah. That is true. Some people would say the same of my new CD, but anyway. but anyway, the thing is, if we had only this principle, we would wake up in the morning, we would open our eyes, and we would be thinking, I can predict everything, I'm just going to stay in bed. That do happen. That does happen, actually. That does happen from time to time. But luckily, there's another principle, and that is, and we know this from rat research, so when we are predicting incorrectly, but what we get is better than we thought. So if you were predicting a piece of cheese and we get chocolate, I hate cheese. But the thing is, so what the music can do is that it can make us predict something very strongly and then play something even better. See, the first thing that happens here is that you say, oh, that's a strange chord, and then you say, ah, it's really nice. Anyway, this is the basic principle. That's how music works. Is it so it can tap into our prediction system, and then by this tap into our dopamine system. It can give us pleasure. But is it good for our survival? I'll talk a little bit about that for the next 40 minutes or so. So these are some of the first instruments known. And so we know that music has been around for human beings. This is, we know for sure that this flute is 35,000 years old. This one, we don't really know whether it's a flute or something that just happened. That's dated from 43,000 years ago. Anyway, Darwin was, I don't know if he was the first, but at least already in his second book, The Descent of Man, he pointed to an evolutionary origin for music. And he said it would be the courtship of the sexes that would be sort of the reason why. And I'll get back to this theory. But basically, you can say that we do have a lot of different theories about why we have music. And they might be right, all of them, and they might not be right. But they come in basically in three flavors. Either it's the so-called transfer effect. We have music because by having music, it's a playground for us to become better at something else. A transfer effect from one cognitive skill, music, to, for instance, language or mathematics or whatever. Then there's the second theory, and that's that it's good for mate-seeking, that we have it in order to be able to attract the other sex. We get on stage, Mick Jagger, and so, and then we have the third one, and that's called basically called group cohesion, that music is an emotional tool for us in order to make our groups more cohesive. Basically, when I start playing the piano and you sing together, it's not for a purpose, it's just to make the group a little bit more cohesive here. We'll get back to these, but I'll spend most time talking about the transfer effect, and I'll probably dismiss it more or less, and then I'll get back to these others. But just let's have a little bit of a look of these two twins. I found them on YouTube not so long ago, and check this out. They're listening to their father's song.
Daddy's gonna play them a little song while you're eating their peas.
You girls ready?
Cheap trick, just show some babies. Anyway, if you look at this, then you can see that music making involves perception. They listen to their father's song, and very importantly, the mother probably says, now you're going to listen to your daddy's song, blah, 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 blah. They don't understand any of it, and the moment he starts playing, they know exactly what this is. So music is sort of even earlier than language in some ways. And it of course involves perception, they're perceiving, but it also involves action, they're moving to the music, and they're actually trying to synchronize. They're really bad at it, but they're trying at least. And of course, they seem to be enjoying it, so it also involves emotion. And very importantly, if you do the same with kids that are like 4 or 5 years old, they have become much better at synchronizing to the beat of the music, something that almost no animals can do, and synchronizing together. So it's something that you learn. And if you think about the brain, that basically is most of the brain. Some of you might know how the brain works, but just to tell you, this is a brain, of course, this is the eyes in this direction, and music perception, of course, involves hearing. So, and that basically takes place in the brainstem and the auditory cortices, and then we have rhythm and motor, so that you move action, you move to it, so you'll have the motor system, that is a big system in the brain. You have the motor cortex, down here you have some motor areas, also the basal ganglia and the cerebellum, of course. And then involves emotional pleasure, which is more the deep midbrain, the limbic system. I love the limbic system, it has such nice names. Amygdala and hippocampus, I love those names. Anyway, and then it's the orbital frontal cortex also, and then we can of course also think about music and use our more cognitive skills, and even music can also involve a visual cortex, which is over here. So basically, what music can activate or lead to activation of basically the whole brain. That's why it's so interesting from a brain science perspective. So, let's get back to it, the transfer effect. It started, or at least it reappeared, in 1993, where a very now famous researcher, Francis Roscher, in Nature, published a very, very short article. It's very, very short, and it's actually easy to read. That's not, you could not say that about everything that's in Nature. But what she showed was that if you play 20 minutes sonata for two pianos in D major, crystal 448, to college students, then they'll score 8 to 9 points higher in intelligence test than if they had been listening to relaxation tapes or sitting in silence. This is Nature, so it was a real big story. It became very, very quickly, it became like this. The music of Mozart, and only the music of Mozart, make you smarter. Actually, in the state of Kansas, they donated $300,000 to the kindergartens for them to make Mozart listening rooms in the kindergartens. So the four-year-olds would go in, and then they would come out and be smarter after having listened to Mozart. Is that true or false, as they say in Detector? We'll get back to that. But one thing that we know is that music changes the brain. So if you practice music, your brain will change. So for instance, this is a very famous study by Gottfried Schlauch. They have measured the thickness of the cortex. And they can see that in piano players, and not only normal piano players, but concert piano players, they can see that in these two areas of the brain, they have more gray matter volume. What do you think these are about in concert piano players? Well, it's the hand areas of the motor cortex. So they simply grow when you practice. And does it make sense that this one in the right hemisphere is smaller than the one in the left hemisphere? Yes, because they use their right hand, which is controlled by the left hemisphere, more than they use the left hand. Of course, they could be born with this, so that's why they became concert piano players. So we have another experiment that was done on the cerebellum. I brought this image because it was the first brain image I ever recorded myself of a musician's brain, actually. And I was sitting in my, I was a PhD student at the time, I was sitting in my office, and I was looking at this and I was thinking, oh, it's so fantastic, for hours. And and then my boss came by, and he's a neurologist. He knew a lot more about the brain than I did at the time, and he said, "Whoa, that's really a large cerebellum." And it turns out that the more hours a day you practice, the more percentage of the whole brain is taken up by the cerebellum. See, that might make you a little bit worried. Because the cerebellum is pretty lame, right? It does what it's told, but it doesn't really have any intelligence. And of course, this is a musician's brain, so when the cerebellum becomes larger percentage-wise, that must mean that some of the real important stuff sort of shrinks. And what makes me really worried is that this is my brain. I know you're laughing, but it's actually the picture that my wife carries in her wallet. That's a lie. Anyway, so this means that it's actually the practice that changes the brain anatomy, and we can measure this. And of course, it also changes our behavior. These are studies where we have shown, and this is not very surprising, that if you test musicians compared to professional musicians compared to amateur musicians and non-musicians in discrimination of melodies and rhythms, you can see that there are actually quite a difference between these. But importantly, and this was the interesting part of this study, They are working memory, musicians working memory. The better you score in these ear tests, the higher your working memory is. What is working memory? Working memory is if I say 1, 3, 7, 9, 2, 5, then you can say it backwards. 1, 2, 3, 9, 5. Just to keep you a little bit on the toes. Anyway, I have to say this is age dependent. If you do this at the high schools, it'll just come like this. You're already late. Okay. Anyway, so another thing, of course, is that if you are a jazz musician, as in this study that Niels Christian Hansen is just defending his PhD on next month, then if you're a jazz musician, your prediction about jazz content in the music will become much sharper. You'll be more precise in your predictions. This is a very difficult research to do, actually, but I won't bother you with the details. Anyway, so of course behavior changes. But how about the brain responses for listening to music, for instance? Do they also change? And I've taken, this was one of the first studies that I did myself. I did it in Finland. And what we did was that we played these very simple music that we broke. They sound like this. And then we record the brain activity very just at exactly this moment where I break the rhythm. And we record it 100 milliseconds after this break. And we record it by a scanner where you can at milliseconds see what actually happens. And they are doing something completely different. They're not attending to this. So it's simply what happens to the brain when you're a musician and listening to these rhythms without anything. And what happened is that you have a completely different processing in the brain in jazz musicians compared to non-musicians. I'm going to show you a little video, but just to give you the take-home message in the end. In the jazz musicians, you see a left hemispheric lateralization, the language hemisphere, whereas in the in non-musicians, you see a right lateralization and not. And the jazz musician's brain responds much more to these deviations in the rhythms than the non-musicians. So see this small video. In the top, you have the musicians. On the bottom, you have the non-musicians. So here you have the musicians. Already something is happening in the right here, in the non-musicians, and the left, in the non-musicians. And see here. Empty. I should say here, we took non-musicians, we selected them to be really bad at rhythms. They were not supposed to be able to keep a rhythm or to be able to dance. I didn't think it was possible, but I tested them myself, they were really bad. I hope there are no Finns today. Yeah. And sorry. Anyway, if you do the same type of experiment exactly modeled, because we modeled this on language studies, then you can see a left lateralization to your mother tongue, to deviations of vowels. But if it's vowels from a tongue from a different language that you don't understand, you see sort of a non-musician type brain processing. And if you, another study showed that if you train people in Morse code, after 3 months, they will have a more musician-like, a left lateralization of this Morse code. And what is Morse code? Basically, Morse code is rhythm that means something. So, of course, this doesn't prove that this is language processing, but at least before I did this study, everybody in the field was saying, well, language is left and music is right. That was a nice, easy story to tell, but I proved that that is not wrong. And fortunately, a lot of studies has come out since that has shown exactly the same thing. We did another study here where you also have a very famous area for language that is activated in musicians when they do polyrhythms, really complex rhythms. So does that actually mean that music makes you smarter? So let's get back to the Mozart story here. We are still on the transfer effect, of course. First explanation. So the Mozart effect, what was it that they showed? So if you put people into a room and they listen to music and not making music, then they become smarter afterwards. Kind of difficult to understand. And when you looked at the data, what they became better at, and you can do this with me, at the intelligence test, was only this type of tests, these types of trials. And it's called the paper folding and cutting task. It means that you have to take this piece of paper, then you fold it and cut off the corners here, and then you have to tell us which of these five it becomes when you unfold it again. And you're, I'm sure you're pretty smart here, so if you take 15 or 20 minutes, I'm sure that everybody will be able to see that this is number C. You can also just read here. If it's too hard to do the other. Anyway, sorry. Just mathematical jokes. Anyway, mathematician jokes. So anyway, the thing is, what does this have to do with music? Very, very strange. You can try to explain, and that many people have tried to explain this, because they wanted this story to be true. Can you see where I'm getting at? But there was another small problem. This effect only lasts for 10 to 15 minutes. Then you are as dumb as when you started. Sorry for making that, but we are, you know, I have to keep you on your toes in some way. I just made this afternoon. Anyway, this is a little bit tricky, right? Because that means you're going to the exam, and you have to really, really listen to some Mozart music, and then you have to rush into the examination room. Yeah, you see what I'm saying. So anyway, what is the cause? And there's been done a lot of studies on this, and I'll spare you for the ugly details of all the studies, but basically what we know now is that it's due to the fact that you're more ready when you have listened to music, and you're also in a better mood. So think about my two. I have a 70-year-old and a 20-year-old boy. If you put them for 20 minutes into a room with silence, what happens? They are asleep, right? So basically, you're just better at doing this. And is it only Mozart, the music of Mozart, that's so fantastic and divine that it works? And I'm so happy that some of my colleagues in England did a study where they compared the music of Blur, you know, in the country, with the music of Mozart, and what do you think works best with the college students, Blur or Mozart? There is a Blur effect. I'm really happy about this because it's kind of course, the music of Mozart is divine in a sense, but there are many divine composers. I would hate to think that, you know, Brahms was sitting around his piano and trying to make these fantastic piano pieces that he's made, or concertos or whatever. And then some brain scientist would come by saying, well, don't bother with it. Mozart has done it. It's you can never be as good as Mozart. It's kind of, I hate the idea. But it has really caught on. That's also what I'm saying. But this, of course, is only listening to music. So, they haven't been trained. What happens if you train people? And if you train people, you actually rearrange the brain. Language areas of the brain can be more developed. This is a very famous study of the symphony orchestra, where you have sort of the same matter of gray volume in the Broca's area, the language area, where it deteriorates in normal people. Verbal memory in children is affected, perception of prosody and intelligence marginally, but unfortunately at the expense of social skills. This is a study on classical lessons where they're sitting in the room and only practicing for themselves. It could have been done in a way so it would come out differently. And of course, we have shown a very clear working memory, and we have done this study 3 times, so we are quite sure that it's true, working memory effect. But working memory is very close to what musicians will do every day of their lives. They will practice a small piece of music, and the next bar, and then they'll make a mistake, and then we'll practice these small segments and put them together, and in the end, you will actually have done a verbal memory task every day. Anyway, so the problem is that these effects are super small. And to be honest, if you want to become better at speaking French, you'll probably not go into the piano study room. You'll probably go to a French class or move to France or whatever. So it's kind of a stretch to say that this should be the best explanation for why we have music. Might be something to it, because of course we know that play is something we play in many different ways. We do sports, we play music, and of course the children of animals also play. But basically, I would have a hard time believing this. How about the second one here, mate-seeking? So if you think about this, this was Darwin's theory, of course. He based it on the comparison to the peacock hen. You all know this story, I'll just tell it one more time. For Prince Knud, as we say in Danish. The thing is that the larger and the more colorful the tail is, the better the peacock, the male peacock is at attracting the females. And it's very interesting because I've seen this live many times, and they have many, many different sizes, and they only grow them in the mating season. So, because they're completely useless for fleeing from some enemy. So it's very dangerous to have this tail, but just to impress the female peacocks, it's very good. I don't know if you can see the comparison to music, but but basically, this is a very famous pianist from my youth. There was a movie about him some years ago. With Michael Douglas as this guy. He was very funny because he said, "This is not the biggest suit I have, but it's the most expensive." It was his rhinestone suit. Anyway, the idea is that the men are standing on stage and they are showing off, and like these 4 guys from Liverpool, of course, and the females are screaming from them. I love Ringo. Especially I like this one that got that caught George Harrison, and he seemed to be liking it also. he cannot sing though, but anyway, there's some truth to this, and there's some things that speak in favor of this theory, because we are most interested in, or our interest in music tops in adolescence. From that time on, it sort of deteriorates, and we sort of tend to listen to the same music here when we get my age as we did when we were trying to find a girl. And of course, it's in adolescence also we really need to attract the other sex. But there are also some problems with this theory. Because in the animal world, it's always either the male or the female that has some special abilities that can attract the other sex. Whereas for human beings, luckily, both male and female are very attractive when they're on stage, and they're attracted to the other sex when they're doing music. And another thing is that why should rock musicians have so much better opportunity than the rest of us? Is that really good for the survival of the human race? Anyway, it's probably not the only explanation we can get. What we think mostly is that music is a main factor in group cohesion. So let's think about this theory just for 1 second. If you think about, for instance, a funeral, you go to a funeral, and the first thing that happens is not that the priest or the vicar is giving us this very sad speech about the person who has died. The first thing that happens is that we listen together to a piece of really sad organ music. Then we sing some really sad songs. We say a little bit in between, but we don't really understand what the priest is saying. And first, after this musical introduction, we are emotionally harmonized as a group and able to grasp this very emotional speech by the priest or the vicar. It would be completely wrong to turn it the other way around. So what it does is basically that we come in, we come into this funeral from quite different angles. We might be stressed, or we might be very sad, or we might be happy for some other reason, and we get emotionally harmonized. It would be very difficult with any other means than music, because music is something that we know from research. You need only a very, very small piece of music in order to understand exactly what the emotion content is. And for instance, if you go to the stadium, you sing completely different songs. It's a different kind of emotion we need. We have to cheer up our team and celebrate when they win and so forth. We have a small problem on the stadium of Aarhus, where I'm from at the moment, because the songs we are singing at the stadium, football stadium, they remind me a little bit about the songs at the funeral. And that has been like that for ages, but I could, of course, move to Copenhagen. That would probably be wiser. But basically, this thing has something going for it. There are things that might tell us that also could contradict this, but that would be the one that I would put most of my money on if I was to put money on this. Anyway, I've reached to the conclusions. What music does is that it's possible to affect the whole brain by different kinds of music. This is just some of our rhythm studies, like language areas of the brain, so you can affect things that are not especially made for music. Also, of course, pleasure and emotion. And this is a very fun study that we really have a lot of success with. It shows you that you need some prediction error. We've talked a lot about prediction error. You need a medium amount of prediction error in order to really engage us, to make us want to move, to dance, and feel pleasure about music. Not too little, and especially not too much, like in jazz. That's too bad, but that's how it is. And you can affect, of course, auditory areas, but also areas for pleasure in the brain. Of course, learning is something that our musical perception, even at the pre-attentive state, where we are not at all thinking about what we're listening to, it makes very a large difference in our brain processing. And of course, it's also very important with synchronization. We have actually just submitted this, where we show that the synchron... 5 minutes, it says. I think I only had 3, so that's fine. Anyway, if you make people have a small whiff of oxytocin, which is a neurohormone suggested to actually make us more cohesive and engaged in each other, then we actually get Even though we don't know that we get the oxytocin, we actually synchronize our tapping together better. Anyway, also that music perception goes left with expertise, as you can see here. It's a quite new study that we have just submitted. And you move the, here you have the non-musician and musicians on a lot of different parts of the music, pitch, timbre, location in the room, intensity, slide, and rhythm. And you can see how it moves from the right hemisphere to the left hemisphere in musicians. And basically, also I have said that perception and action are closely linked. So this is if you do the rhythm test score, this is also completely new, we just got this data, and it's a very nice correlation with the number of correctly performed rhythms. So perception and action is part of the same story in the brain. That's a whole different talk. Anyway, now comes the really hairy part. I just save it for the last when you're really sharp and into this. So basically, prediction, music is based on prediction, as I started out by saying, and predictive coding is the fundamental principle, we think, in perception and learning and in the way that the brain works. So what the brain, all the areas, small areas in the brain, what they do, they are organized hierarchically. And so at the lower level, we have an input. And if the input doesn't fit the model, the idea we have of what is going to come, our predictive model, then it feeds forward a prediction error and it gets a new model in return. And this happens in a hierarchical manner. And it can explain this way of modeling this mathematically, can explain both how we perceive stuff, but actually also how we act on stuff, so when we move. So this is the same mathematical model for how the brain works, the same machinery that drives perception and action. And this is sort of also this with music, and not to bother you with this, but this is basically the same where you have an input and you are calculating the probability that the model you have, the predictive model, is actually correct. And why am I saying this? It's because prediction and anticipation is closely linked, as we know from the studies, is closely linked to the reward system and the dopamine spiking per se. So if you start out by giving a mouse a piece of cheese that it likes, then over time it'll diminish the dopamine that it gets from actually getting it, because now if you ring a bell or light a flash at this moment, so they know they get the reward, you see the anticipation reward here. So you get the dopamine here instead of at the actual. And when you then don't, when the researcher then don't give the rat the reward, then the dopamine will drop. Do you know that feeling? Worst feeling in the world. Anyway, so, and very importantly, no learning without prediction. So it's both, it's about perception, but it's also about learning. So prediction is the basic principle behind dopamine release, so the reward. And if we didn't have reward, we would probably, but with music, we would probably not have music. So why do we have music? I think if I should put percentages, I would say 5, 30, 65 on these three. But there's another explanation, and that is that music simply is a lucky coincidence. And basically, music found out that by using these anticipatory structures in the brain that was actually made for our survival, it could actually grasp our attention like a drug. Fortunately, it's not that dangerous to take. Basically, I'll just finish this by showing you the only animal we know that can actually dance to music, keep the rhythm. We think it's very easy, it's very difficult for animals. The thing is about this that it only likes the Backstreet Boys. It's called Snowball. Thank you very much.